Ladies and gentlemen, I think this is a very important event where we are discussing all different aspects of smart grid and really electric vehicles and the EV ecosystem, charging, battery, all these are very important elements of the whole thing, how we can work upon them. And I think for the past few days and the next couple of days, you'll be getting good insights on these areas. I'll share my perspective, what we are doing as an organization, what we believe in, and what is our outlook. So basically, as we see, you know, today in this scenario, what we are trying to see is that how the smart mobility revolution is happening. In this case, what we are seeing is that there is an outlook which we have across different countries in the world. When we see that in today's day and age, multiple new launches are happening globally, a lot of new vehicles are converting. There's so much of investments which are happening in EV startups. And at the same time, the parity is coming closer. The kind of battery technologies which are coming up are more efficient, density is higher, charging time is reducing. So there are many such opportunities which are coming by and reducing the anxiety for the end customer who wants to use an electric vehicle but today wants to understand it better. It should not disrupt one's operating cycle, what we are used to, of refueling the vehicle, using the vehicle, whether the vehicle will stop on the way or not. So all those range anxiety issues also are getting addressed. And there's a very fast change in the kind of costs for batteries, for electric vehicles. And since the government is focusing on multiple such programs, that offers opportunities and challenges together. How we address them is the key. But why are we talking about EV? I think that is very important to understand for us. So there are multiple disruptors. India as a country today imports very substantially, more than 70-80% of its electric vehicle or fuel required for vehicle, sorry. And that's why electric vehicles are important, and there's a lot of pollution which is being caused by the IC engine vehicles, even though now we are moving to BS6, but still we see that the many older vehicles on the road, the government is bringing in the scrappage policies and other policies to remove those vehicles from the road. And simultaneously, new energy vehicles, as they call them today, where in zero emission is the main target and electric is the most promising technology in zero emission today. And their transportation is a big cause which I have tried to address here. So there are multiple kinds of fuel in clean mobility. As I said, target is not purely electric, target is clean mobility, target is zero emission. In that, electric is very promising today. So we've tried to see how are we mapping from generation to consumption. Perspective is not to look at only half-hearted perspective of the vehicle, but how the generation is also getting mapped. As in our country, now we are seeing a big focus on renewable energy. We are already having about 175 gigawatt program until 2022, and now we are talking about 450 gigawatts for the next decade. So definitely, whatever is being generated should be green and up to the consumption level, but every value chain causes disruptions. So how are we able to manage those disruptions and how comfortably that transition takes place is the differentiator. So here we've tried to see that how in different value chains are different disruptions, but definitely considering those and a longer term perspective, electric is considered as a good technology because the number of moving parts, if I see it in an electric bus also, are reduced from about 1800 moving parts to 18 moving parts. So the maintenance, the kind of vehicle which is available to any end consumer, and that is what is used by mass consumers as a mode for public transportation and mass adoption, which is being focused upon. So there are multiple push and pull factors for such kind of vehicles, where we see that CO2 reduction is a focus for governments. We are seeing that in different cases, they are being incentivized when they are getting parking free. They are also seeing that multiple parameters which are impacting such kind of programs are having that there's a good focus on new EV technologies. R&D is a prime focus area. Government is seeing that how the whole ecosystem is evolving as we move forward. And many private companies who are in different phases are coming together and seeing that how the market is developing. It's a constantly evolving. Every day is a new day and you are improving from the previous day. How fast that evolution happens is what is going to be essential here. So there are multiple measures which are being taken by different governments. Somewhere we are seeing they're deploying charging infrastructure across different parts of the country. We are seeing a lot of money is being invested in fleets because they're seeing that in fleets, the utilization is much higher. The kind of utilization in fleets goes up to about 250, 300 kilometers a day. So the asset utilization is much better vis-a-vis a personal mobility, which is 30 to 50 kilometers a day on an average across the world. So here, and financial institutions are coming up with new kind of instruments for funding such kind of models where they are also having certain anxiety, but that is getting addressed over a period of time. how new structures are getting created in research. Also, new chemistries are coming up which are being used. So definitely there are many ways and means which are being adopted today. But definitely the evolution takes time, and we are seeing that battery prices are going down, density is increasing. The recycling is also an important part which is being touched upon in many countries all over the world. What will happen end of life, how it can be reused for energy storage. Similarly, for a common man, as I was sharing, range anxiety is a concern. Will it stop on the way? What will happen vis-a-vis what I'm using today? So all those issues are getting addressed as we move forward. There's no immediate solution for 100% of the things, but definitely as we progress through policy interventions, through collaborative work which is happening between different stakeholders, it is getting addressed. And now as we are moving, we have moved from BS4 to BS6, so the parity would also become better between electric vehicles, because with BS6 the prices of the vehicles will go up, and on the other side the EV prices are becoming more competitive as we move forward. The availability and the other aspects with respect to the maintenance cost is about 25 to 30%, what we see especially in fleets vis-a-vis a CNG or a diesel or a petrol, so any fossil fuel based vehicle. So that is an important driver here as well. So definitely there are multiple modes of green transportation. So we see from two-wheeler to buses, and in every area there are different leading area perspectives where the segments are leading here, whether we talk about scooters or the taxis, because that is where the highest utilization of vehicles are going to be. So that is going to be the first mover in the EV space. And there are multiple stakeholders, as we were discussing, in the ecosystem. So whether it's the OEMs, or we talk about EV aggregates or charging infra or big data, because the analytics part cannot be ignored at any point in time, because that is how you're getting the real-time feedback regarding your equipment, regarding your structures, which can be really well used. So here, I'll take an example of electric buses, because that is something which we understand very well. So even though in Western world we see that it is about 71% more efficient in the ideal conditions, but even if we take Indian road conditions, Indian environment, Indian climatic conditions, still there's a 42% improvement in the electric buses with such scenarios. But what are the kind of benefits we talk about when we see smart electric buses? Definitely we talk about zero pollution, we see that the noise level goes down substantially. Simultaneously, there are multiple benefits with respect to the whole connected system, so real-time data is available to us. We are also trying to understand that how in such kind of vehicles safety is enhanced, because for passenger safety we need to see that how passenger safety is being given that kind of value, and it is a top priority for us. So in such cases we have a real-time understanding of any issues in battery, any issues in chargers or power electronics in our vehicle. So it's a very proactive approach for giving any solutions other than reactive approach like what we see in many fossil fuel based vehicles. And we are able to schedule our vehicles in a much better way. So these are certain benefits which we have tried to capture here. So efficiency and effectiveness goes up substantially here. So as we all know that the government is focusing on this through FAME II, there are multiple initiatives being taken. So now I'll talk about the EV components and aggregates. So all of us understand that these are very critical, how they are getting localized. The government is trying to see that India is a leader in this space. So we always compare electric to solar. So in solar, what happened in 10 years, definitely we became a very large IPP country, EPC country, but manufacturing lost steam. So that is a very important part, how we are making in India, making for India, and the whole supply chain benefit is coming to Indian companies, whether it is MSMEs or large corporates or startups in the ecosystem. So such kind of opportunities are there, which can be really well utilized by all of us, depending on our competencies in different sectors, which can be horizontally deployed. So there are multiple kind of chemistries, as we see, as I was talking. So this is a 12 to 13 year roadmap, what we have tried to deploy here. So how in next 6 to 7 years, things would improve from where they were, and simultaneously the TCO. So electric vehicle is all about total cost of ownership. total cost of ownership improves, and the customer is able to get a better understanding of the product. So that's why it's very important that how we convert this into layman perspective very clearly, where different battery chemistries perform in a different way. So there's no good or bad. It is all linked to the application. If you are having a fast charge discharge cycle vis-a-vis a stationary power in a BESS perspective, or a smaller size of battery where you are able to go to 100% DoD, I think every battery really performs differently for different applications, as well as in climatic conditions, what you are having, what kind of cooling you are providing to the battery. So basis that, you choose which battery is most suitable for your application. As I was mentioning earlier, battery recycling is very important because end of life needs to be taken up. So this is a great opportunity for the industry today, because as the industry grows, definitely a lot of batteries will be coming out. And today we keep hearing everywhere that the reserves of lithium, cobalt, nickel, manganese in many cases are not in control of India. So with this recycling, we will be able to give a complete end-to-end perspective how these batteries can be giving those precious metals back to the manufacturers of producing within India, and we are not creating any toxic waste. So with battery recycling, we are addressing the issue of toxic waste also after a given point, and clearly seeing that we are moving in the right direction. So it's a very holistic approach, which is taken in a comprehensive manner, rather than purely focusing on EV and other things and not seeing that the total environment is being protected around it. Similarly, we've tried to see how in different areas, in traction motors where permanent magnets or hub reduction motors or other chemistry, centralized motors are being there, which can benefit the vehicles. Vehicles become more efficient. As it is, we see that the RPM and the pickup of such kind of vehicles, torque is much better in electric vehicles. So now I'll touch upon the charging perspective. So here we see that there are multiple stakeholders today when we talk about charging as a service, and for all different aspects in different segments of electric vehicles, these stakeholders have to come together and really work together, because no one company would be able to give 100% solutions. So the collaborative approach is going to be a key for EV segment, and for companies to really see that what we'll see the results on the ground. So that will come through this, whether it's DISCOMs, real estate developers, OEMs, or charging as a service organization. So all of them will collaborate to give such kind of a solution where we are having a very high density of chargers and EV solutions across the country. Definitely, I think these policy frameworks are available to us today, how we can have charging stations at home or in public domain. But I think this is a very critical slide. So what we are seeing here, the initiatives which are being taken, so this captures almost everything what we've been discussing until now. So clearly, how it is important that each and every element, whether we talk about skill, we talk about R&D, we talk about product, we talk about a clear roadmap, where we clearly see that the states, the center, different cities are taking a very holistic view when they are having a master plan for their cities. They are capturing these things so that they can be well planned and they are not being developed on an ad hoc manner. So that is what we have seen, like in many cases, good cities like Amsterdam and many other cities, they have gone for such kind of plans. So for a comprehensive success, industry academy relationship and connect is very important. A lot of different startups are coming up with new technologies which can be adopted, and their agility is very high, so which many times we see in larger corporates we miss out on. So definitely with this and the technology roadmap clearly coming up, where battery or motor or other key aggregates are improving significantly on density, efficiency and effectiveness, it will make it a very important journey and evolution. So what happened in the last 100 years in the automotive industry with the ICE engine, we see that in next 10 years to 15 years itself, so in a much shorter span of time, will happen in the EV space. So all of us will be part of this transition one way or the other. So as I was saying, that the data analytics is very important, because in all these cases, the real-time data which different manufacturing companies, ecosystem companies, or charging companies, battery companies needs to have, that the real-time data from the road conditions is important. So how we are able to analyze all these things, how we are able to clearly see that we capture this data and use it for new product development, use it for creating the right technologies required for different applications, would be a differentiator between different companies. And that is how the collaboration will also become more efficient and effective. So here we've just tried to capture how in every case we are increasing the efficiency, the uptime for the grid, for chargers, and the vehicles are also becoming more efficient from that perspective. So keeping all these factors in mind, we have a JVM ecosystem approach which we deploy. We try and see that starting from vehicle to key aggregates to power, charging, ITS and operation maintenance, how everything is integrated and you are having a clear perspective around it. We as a company are also seeing that we are talking about a well-to-wheel concept, what I was sharing initially. So generation to consumption. And here clearly we see that the solar power is being used for generating power, whether through net metering or in different depots or in terminals. And we are working very closely with charging companies and using our buses and batteries for the same. So this is a well-to-wheel concept. So oil well to a car wheel or a vehicle wheel, everything has to be green. So generation to consumption. So this is what we are doing in electric buses, different kind of buses which we are manufacturing. Already we see them plying in different parts of India now. And every bus saves about 1,000 tons of CO2 and about 3.5 lakh liters of diesel in its lifetime, which is a very substantial contribution, because that's where I started from. What is the issue we are trying to resolve? So whether it's pollution, environment, or the burden on the forex reserves, which we are having today, the import bill as a country on crude oil. So perspective ideally is all solutions are available to us locally, but we need to benchmark with different cities, different companies globally. So as an organization, we always have this motto, think global, act local, because local challenges need local solutions, which have to be frugal, which have to understand the needs of the customer, so it can't be a copy paste. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much, and it was nice that you covered the entire ecosystem and the value chain. We'll just ask you to stay back a little more, because if you wish to go, why don't you take the questions in first?
Yeah, sure. I can
But before you do that, may I provoke you with one query? You covered the entire value chain from green generation, of course you stressed on that. One input, of course, you must have heard about ABB's fast charger for buses. Maybe we could hear some more about that or something similar, because with buses, the key thing that gives you a return on investment or efficiency, of course, is the range. And I wanted to provoke you by asking you, if there's one change that you would like to see in the ecosystem today, what would that be?
Okay. So I think the fast charger given by ABB is quite apt, and that would be quite suitable for the industry. We just have to see that the infrastructure required for that kind of charging, how would you provide that, and on a sustainable basis, so that that charger can be used and well deployed across all cities in the country by all kind of buses. And today we do not have a standard battery or charging system in our case. Every company is doing it in their own way. So I think once those things get ironed out and there's a standard in place, that would really help for it to scale up, and that reduces the time to market for any end customer, where we see that the turnaround time for any bus, like today if we talk about that kind of charging or pantograph charging, within a couple of minutes, it's an approach of top-up approach, where you top up the vehicle with a little more charge for going for next 10, 20 kilometers, 30 kilometers, which is different in different cases. So how one is able to manage that, one has to see. Second question which you asked me was regarding one thing. I think one thing is that all the stakeholders need to see that this collaboration is going to be very, very important. No one company can do it. And here, consistent process of learning and evolutionizing and working at an ecosystem level is what would take India to the apex level very soon. And already we see that with the FAME II program. So FAME II program many times is considered as the ultimate thing. It's a program to create the right inertia in the system, which can get things going. But then things would happen on their own in different cities, different parts of the country, because the demographic and geographic requirements for each city, each state, or every country is very different. And the people who are working at the local level understand them the best.
Any questions?
There are two things as far as creating ecosystem for EVs are concerned. One is, of course, the economics, because currently economics still are not in favor of EVs, going by IC engine and the kind of oil prices which are there. The second thing is that what kind of charging ecosystem are we thinking about? Are we thinking about the group charging ecosystem for EVs, like what we have the petrol and diesel dispensing systems? Now, what had happened is that when CNG came, the number of course CNG stations came along by IGL and MGL and the number of other companies which are coming up. But then the oil company, they had put one or two CNG stations next to their dispensing units of diesel and petrol. Now, do we think that, these companies, they are the energy provider, they should also have some kind of EV dispensing, EV charging panels also. So one has to really think about the long-term charging ecosystem to be created. And the second thing is that what should be the economics at large to make EVs coming to a commercial stage? Thank you.
No, I think definitely, as I said, that every city, every location would have its own model. So there's no one model which will succeed. In certain cases, you mentioned about the hybrid model where different gas stations, fuel stations can be used. In some cases, people are creating complete EV charging parks where they'd be used. In other cases, people would have home charging. Then we'd also have chargings in different buildings and commercial areas. But definitely, I think we can have a deeper discussion on this. Now, actually, I have to move. So maybe there was another question. I'll just take that. Yeah.
Hurry, Nitin, but I just wanted to understand, do you have
so
any
you
visibility?
A little louder, yeah.
Okay, I just wanted to just tell me
wait,
if there...
Can you just identify yourself?
Okay, fine. So I'm Anupam Mathur. I'm from Snell Charge. We are starting the manufacturing of charging stations. We have been installing them. And yeah, so I wanted to understand if you have a visibility on the problems which the charging station manufacturer will have, especially on the land front. The land is a major issue, and also if there is a visibility on the cost of the power which a charging station investor has to bear. There is a clause that it is going to be open access is allowed. Open access comes only after 1 megawatt of single metering. So is there any discussion with at the government level to help the investors in the charging stations?
See, many cities and different states have gone for subsidized rates for electric vehicles, which they have done, which like in Delhi and other places, is 4.5, 5 rupees, some are 5.5 rupees. Similarly, what government earlier took as a step, which was not there, so they made charging as a service, as a part of the Electricity Act, so you could deploy that. So those changes are slowly coming. So I would not say 100% issues are getting resolved immediately, but as the time goes by and things become evident, I feel that in different states, it may be different, but at the central level, the government is ready to listen and understand what are the requirements. Simultaneously, for uptime and for LAN and other kind of technology issues, I think multiple DESCOMs and others have also started taking those initiatives. How can they themselves support the EV charging companies and collaborate with them? So that's also working out in certain cases, because also it depends on the kind of capacity you have for your EV charger and what size is the EV charger. That would determine the power requirements and at what durations do you need it consistently or do you need it few times a day. So that those are certain questions which would need to be answered for addressing this issue, which I think there is a good connect between the government and different associations and corporates. So multiple working groups are working on such kind of challenges today.
Just one small submission. Why not collaborate with oil companies so that you don't have an issue of land, you don't have an issue of, it could be put up in a very small period of time. So that kind of ecosystem, I think one can think about. Oil companies need to be talked, of course. The power tariff is one of the issue which is going to be taking time, but then solar too. Storage and then EVs could be one of the...
Sure, definitely. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
One small short question.
Sorry about this.
Yeah.
If you do.
maybe some of the other participants could take that very relevant question. Yes.
Maybe, sir.
Nishant, thank you so much.
Before that, Mr. Rajani, if you could give him a small token of our appreciation. Yes. You've got a memento for all our speakers. So, from our chair to our eminent speaker, huge round of applause for Mr. Nishant Agarwal.